Second, Webb continuously tries to paint the Parkes Observatory as independent verification, claiming that it was owned and operated by the CSIRO, not NASA. Owned by the CSIRO? Yes.
Whoa! What was that?
Owned by the CSIRO? Yes.
Where did that come from? I thought Jarrah was adamant that NASA owned Parkes.
As I pointed out quite clearly in Exhibit D, the tracking stations in Goldstone, Australia, and also Madrid are all owned by NASA, and therefore are not independent parties, as the propagandists have claimed. Because it was NASA's radio telescopes tracking NASA's spacecraft, it was essentially the metaphoric equivalent to the fox guarding the henhouse.
Earlier, Jarrah said that there were only two points for my critique of Australia and the conspirators that warranted his attention. Of course, a major portion of that critique refuted his claim that Parkes was owned by NASA. Now he agrees with me, without so much as his usual, I made an honest mistake disclaimer? Wow.
The five-part series has to be by far the weakest pro-NASA video since Astro Brand 2's video on reflected light.
And yet, the evidence presented in that series, which apparently doesn't warrant Jarrah's attention, was strong enough to get him to change his mind about who owned Parkes. Imagine that.
Owned by the CSIRO? Yes. Operated by the CSIRO? Not during the Apollo days. As I prominently showed in my Australia and the Conspirators video, all operations at Parkes during the Apollo days were carried out under the control of NASA. Not only was Parkes part of the NASA manned spaceflight network, NASA's Robert Taylor was in charge of the operations during the Apollo days and controlled all the data that Parkes relayed to the network. Webb completely ignored this in his critique. Hard to imagine why.
Ah yes, the good old Apollo days. So, how could I have ignored all this evidence? Perhaps because it isn't true? Now that Jarrah finally agrees that NASA doesn't own Parkes, didn't own Parkes, never did own Parkes, could he still be right when he says that NASA operated Parkes during the Apollo days? Could it be possible that the CSIRO rented out their Parkes Observatory like a country club would rent out a ballroom for a wedding reception? Not really. The only evidence Jarrah can offer to attempt to substantiate this claim is this tourist photo of four NASA GSFC engineers who visited Parkes Observatory during the Apollo 11 mission. Just who are the four gentlemen in this photo, and why were they there? Alfred Stella was the expert on the NASA-supplied tape recording and TV monitoring equipment. George Kropp was the expert on the NASA-supplied S-band equipment. William Rader was the expert on the NASA-supplied receiving equipment, and Robert Taylor, an old radar engineer, managed the NASA operations at Parkes. In other words, Robert Taylor coordinated the efforts of the three other GSFC engineers. These men were specialists on the equipment they brought along, and Robert Taylor's only concern was that the TV picture sent out from Parkes was as good as it could be. Does it sound like any of these four men even have the credentials to have been able to operate a radio telescope by themselves? Not really. Nor did they need to. When customers buy time on Parkes radio telescope, they also buy the time of Parkes trained employees to operate that equipment. While quick to point out a photo of four NASA boys on the Parkes website, Jarrah ignores other photos that include other key players at Parkes, like John Bolton, the director of Parkes Observatory, and Taffy Bowen, the chief of CSIRO's radio physics division. Or how about Fox Mason, who was the guy driving the antenna? During the Apollo 11 EVA, he was constantly monitoring the signal strength and nudging the antenna periodically to keep it on target, sitting upstream of the NASA equipment. If there wasn't a spacecraft sitting on the moon transmitting that signal, he would have known it. And there are other photos showing other CSIR employees present at Parkes during the Apollo 11 mission. Why would Jarrah completely ignore these photos? Oh, right. Because they don't have anything to do with his claim. That seems perfectly Jarrah logical to me. And, as I've pointed out before, Jarrah completely ignores all the other Apollo missions. These four NASA engineers were only present at Parks during the Apollo 11 mission. The Apollo days, as Jarrah stated three times in one of the previous clips, lasted from July 1969 to December 1972. Parks was used during critical phases of other missions after Apollo 11, without any assistance from NASA personnel. In fact, Parks Observatory, manned solely by our CSIRO staff, actually played a major role in the rescue of Apollo 13. The 64-meter Parks antenna had a narrower beam width than the 26-meter dish at Honeysuckle Creek, and was able to isolate the lunar module transmissions from the nearby S4B that was broadcasting on the same frequency. So, can a legitimate claim be made that Parks was operated by NASA during the Apollo days? Absolutely not. Ciao, Moon Hoax Conspirators, wherever you are.